Tonight on the Pioneer Sideline, running to a second chance. The story of Anna Shields and her journey to becoming one of the top runners in the country.
Snowed out, the baseball team moving games from Friday and Saturday to Monday and Tuesday. See if the Pioneers are still undefeated in conference play.
And opening day, the start of the MLB season is just 2 days away. What players were watching for in 2018.
It's time to come on down to the Pioneer Sideline.
The baseball team entered the weekend with a perfect 9-0 record in conference play and looked to go into double digits yesterday. Good evening, I'm Josh Krupp.
And I'm Sarah Maculin. Point Park had to host games an hour north of campus in Butler due to last week's snowfall.
Yeah, good old Butler, Pennsylvania, Sarah. That was on Monday yesterday, but today they're in Washington. Let's bring in a Butler native right now to break down how the Pioneers fared yesterday and today with Allison Schubert. Are they still undefeated? We'll start with that after three games against conference team Asbury.
They are still undefeated. They are 12-0 now, and by a pretty hefty margin too this weekend. They shut out Asbury on yesterday, and then they won 14-4 today. So they're still pretty dominant.
So we talked about they're dominant, their bats are going, but the pitching staff is what's been key to this Point Park team. Talk about how they've been doing just in these past couple games.
Sure. So Nick Beardsley started off with game one in Butler on Monday, and he is 22 2/3 innings without an earned run. So he's pretty much killing it. He threw six scoreless innings, and he earned the victory to improve to 4-1, and then Ryan Huber came in to pitch that final inning. And then the second game, Felix Castillo and Addison Domingo combined for 12 total strikeouts, and Domingo tallied his fifth save of the year. Castillo improves. He's undefeated right now. He's 5-0. And then earlier today, Bucci started. He pitched three innings, but he did give up two runs in the first. So then Addison Domingo came in, and he pitched the next four innings, and Pino finished it out for the last 2/3 of an inning.
But it's not very often that Point Park gives up runs or walks. Three walks today is a season high. So three, that's not a lot at all. The pitching staff really has been dominant. Where are they stacking up in terms of pitching staffs in the rest of the NAI?
Well, I mean, right now they've faced all teams that have a batting average that's below 300, so I don't really think you can compare them at the moment because they aren't really facing teams that have hot bats, which doesn't really say that they're a bad pitching staff because they're not by any means, but I don't really think it's fair to compare them to other pitching staffs because of the level that they're at right now.
Now, we've seen them just keep improving in the NAIA rankings. They were at 22, now they're at 16. Hopefully after this week we see a little bit more of a spike, but it's kind of hard for them to get up there because they're not facing those top-notch teams. So what do you see for Point Park in terms of getting those numbers up there but also trying to make the most of the competition they're facing?
I mean, I think this is a very good way to start the season, obviously, but I think this is good to get their confidence up, get their momentum up to face those tougher teams, and then I think it's just going to be how they can prepare mentally and if they can keep up that strong pitching and if they can keep the bats going through those tougher teams.
And the strong pitching is the best in the NAI. Statistically, even though they face some bad teams, a team ERA of 1.41, opponent batting average of 1.89, tops in the country in both of those categories, that is hard to beat. And they're not needing a lot of offensive help, but they're getting it right.
Oh, absolutely. They're outscoring opponents right now 185-39.
That's unbelievable.
And then, like I said, we won 11-0 for the first game, 4-0 on the second game, so it was a little bit closer, and then 14-4 today. So we've been completely
on both sides. Right. You got the hitting and you got the shutouts. Yes, I mean, yes. Yesterday with two shutouts, that's... You'd like to, despite them not facing the greatest batting averages, they're still holding teams to shutouts, and that's mm-hmm. definitely saying something.
Right, and the teams, too, when guys are getting on base, even in the rare instances that they do, they don't go far. And these games are nine-inning games. The first game of the series and the last one, there are three guarantees. So game one and three, they didn't go nine innings. There's a 10-run rule in the NAIA now. That was done by the seventh inning. Today, they didn't go nine innings again.
Yeah, they only went eight today. they ended up scoring two more runs at the top of the eighth, which kept the game going a little bit longer. But then we got three more runs in the bottom of the eighth, which was, I guess you could say, a walk-off single
right.
by Richie Perez. He did get a single, which sent Merkanja across home plate, and that was the end of the game.
Yeah, Merkanja came back and had,
right.
we talked about this coming into the show today, had an impressive outing for his first game back from injury. He scored, five runs?
He went 3-for-4 with 5 runs today. First series back after taking some time off with a hamstring injury that's kind of lingered, but he is back. It's good to see him in the lineup. Not leading off today, hitting second. Cole Haru has really settled into that leadoff spot, and it looks like they're going to keep him there. We'll see if the team can keep up its role. Thank you so much, Allison. Coming up next, she had all the potential in the world and then gave up.
But she eventually bounced back and found her second chance here at Point Park.
Now she's one of the top runners in the country and isn't slowing down anytime soon. The story of Anna Shields is next.
Whatever happened to predictability? The milkman, the paperboy, evening TV. You miss your old familiar friends with waiting just around the bend.
Spending just 7 minutes climbing stairs each day cuts your risk of a heart attack in half over 10 years. Sure, elevators are convenient, but you burn twice the number of calories just going upstairs than you do while jogging. Think about how long you spend waiting for elevators. The average person spends the equivalent of 2 years waiting for elevators over the course of their lifetime. Don't let that be you. Save time and increase energy. Next time, take the stairs.
Let's go. Ow.
Welcome back. The outdoor track season is officially underway.
And Point Park had some impressive finishes at the cold season opener Saturday, led, of course, by Anna Shields.
And she posted one of the best 5K times in the country and set a meet record in the process.
The successes have piled on for Shields in the past year and a half since she joined the Point Park track program, but at one point, she thought she didn't have it anymore.
So she gave up and spent time working at her bank in her hometown.
Her bounce-back story is inspiring and one that tells us that even though quitting may be an option, it doesn't have to mean that we can't go back.
The old saying goes, success is earned, not given. For Anna Shields, the road to success has given her anything but a conventional path. She was one of the top runners in New England and the country when she was a junior at Lewis Mills High School in Connecticut. She had several NCAA Division I offers and signed a letter of intent to attend the University of North Carolina. But her times took a step back during her senior year.
I felt maybe it's not, like, even though I want this, maybe I can't have it.
Shields never became a Tar Heel. Instead, she enrolled at Central Connecticut. She left after a year and a half and worked at a bank in her hometown of Torrington, Connecticut.
I thought, oh, I don't have it anymore. I'm not really meant to be a runner, which was a huge heartbreak because it was a big dream of mine throughout high school. And
after taking time off racing regularly, Shields eventually competed in some road races. and dominated.
So this is a very exciting race to have someone show up and just take the lead like this. We do not have her name on the registration list.
My high school coach told me that the NAIA I would still have eligibility for.
The closest NAIA school to Torrington, Connecticut? Point Park University.
She contacted me via telephone. She left me a message. I called her right back. She left a message saying, hi. I couldn't hear what she said, her name was, because she's kind of soft-spoken. And she said some of her times, and I was like, this isn't real.
Coach Parsley was so excited immediately. Like, he wasn't skeptical that I could do it. He had a lot of faith in me right away, and so that got me really excited about it too. And it made it feel like, wow, like maybe this could really be something.
And it was, and then some. The 27-year-old has exceeded expectations and continues to push her limits. She became the first Point Park national champion in any sport when she won the 1500 meters at the NAIA Outdoor Track and Field National Championships in 2017. After an All-American cross-country season, Shields dominated the 2018 indoor track season, winning the NAIA Indoor Track Athlete of the Year honor after winning national championships in the mile and 1,000 meters.
She's really like nothing I've ever seen in my years of coaching, but if anyone had the opportunity to coach her, they would see what she's able to do. The fact that she can pretty much get better almost every week. Even professional runners go through lulls. Even the best runners in Division I go through lulls where they'll have like a whole season where they just don't run great. Anna has just been getting better and better and better.
From Point Park University, Anna Shields.
Her successful Point Park journey still has four more seasons. But her resume is already Hall of Fame worthy after five seasons between cross country, indoor, and outdoor track. Since the start of 2017, Shields has tallied seven NAIA All-American honors and has some of the top times in the country in multiple events. So what's next?
This next year is going to be all about what can we do to make her faster, putting her in events that are strategic and keeping her healthy, because again, she runs a lot and relatively injury-free, so she's really strong and amazing. And not only that, she's a 3.8 student, so she's everything. She's everything. She's a poster child for Point Park Athletics, and I couldn't be more proud of anybody.
Well, I did what I thought I could do, but now what do I think I could do? I don't know. The goals are getting kind of crazy, but I have to keep thinking of it my normal way, which is that I want to keep improving every time I race.
Her journey to success showed promise from the beginning. All the doubts and uncertainty are in her past. She overcame doubts she and others had about her potential, even though it took some time. For Shields, that was all just part of the process.
Even though those years were painful, I wouldn't change a thing.
The road to earning success is unpredictable. If Anna Shields has proven anything on her journey, it's that giving up doesn't have to mean there's no turning back.
We're joined now in studio by Nick Kosiski. Nick, so clearly Anna Shields is an important part of this team, right? But so how does she contribute to the team as a leader? How did the other members of the Point Park track and field team view her?
Well, she's very motivational. Just like in what she says and in her story. And another thing is, like, she's always cheering people on. And so it's like she's not only good on the track, but she's a very good teammate off the track as well. And, you know, just like that motivation is something that, you know, the team uses to even drive themselves. I mean, like, when you're part of a team, when someone does good, that motivates you because, you know, it is a team sport.
Sure.
I mean, even though you run independently, team sport when, you know, all comes down into the end.
And she's someone very humbling. Like when Josh did this story with her, I mean, she's not one to boast about all the awards that she's won. And
no,
so how does that humbleness kind of feed into this Point Park track team?
I think it definitely sets an example. And it also really shows that she has been through a lot. But, you know, it's like she used that doubt as fuel to the fire. Because, you know, look at her times now. Like, it's insane. Especially what she did at the last meet. I mean,
Well, let's talk about that.
Yeah,
improving on her times in the last meet, qualifying for nationals, 1500.
Yes.
So she's already in for outdoor nationals.
And then the 5K was crazy too.
5K.
She PR'd by 19 seconds.
It's
unbelievable. From last year.
It's unbelievable. She's one of a kind. What about the other athletes at this outdoor invitation? We're doing this story because this outdoor season's starting. One of four seasons she has left here, which she has some time left here, folks. Tell us about the other athletes at the Cal U Invitational to open up the 2018 outdoor season.
There's a lot of first places definitely at that meet. Dry Davis, he won a triple jump, and then Sean Berry won the long jump, and then Kemi won the 200, and the girls 4x4, they crushed it. And Kara Ralph, actually, she had a huge PR in the 10K, and it was her birthday weekend. So what a good way to celebrate, am I right?
Right.
And now, it wasn't the best conditions this weekend at Cal U. It was cold outside, but yet you still had some success. But for some of the track athletes that didn't necessarily do exactly what they wanted to or do their best, how's the rest of the season, the upcoming meets look for them?
It's definitely going to get better from here. And even if the weather is still bad, it plays a slight part, but it all comes down to, like, you know, what people want to run. And, you know, I'm sure that this team will improve. I also want to give a shout out to Xavier Stevens. He ran a 4:02 in the 1500. So he's really close to breaking that 4-minute barrier, which is crazy.
And if he runs that when it's cold, who knows what he does whenever it actually gets hot.
Exactly.
Point Park is hosting the conference championships again. It'll be at Robert Morris, and it'll be at the end of the season, the day before graduation.
Wow.
So we'll go see Point Park hopefully take home an outdoor title. It's them and Ryo. Ryo's one of the last 3 years. We'll see if Point Park can finally get over that hump. Thank you very much, Nick Kaczynski. Ahead, the latest headlines from around the country and the region.
And what Major League stars to watch as the baseball season gets underway this Thursday. Don't go anywhere.
UView Television at Point Park University, celebrating 10 years of student-run college television. UView is for you, providing authentic, hands-on experience to students in a professional environment that prepares them for the real world. The 100% student-run and student-managed television station equips students with the professional and personal skills needed to compete for jobs upon graduation. UView has an emphasis on service, collaboration, and innovation. UView is in its second year utilizing two professional studios for its shows in the heart of downtown Pittsburgh, including the new Center for Media Innovation. Students gain hands-on experience working on various shows that UView has to offer on air and behind the scenes. They're able to get in front of the camera and work with professional equipment right from the start. UView, celebrating 10 years of student-run college television.
55% of all U.S. multiracial adults have been subjected to racial slurs or jokes.
Where were you born?
Being smart.
Pale.
To a Filipino.
To be
go
white.
Back to Mexico.
There goes that black boy over there. You like fried chicken because you're light skinned. You are cocky. You think that you're better than us. The N-word.
They're good at jumping or climbing.
Border hopper.
Made.
Taco.
English your second language.
Where's your green card?
Cut the jokes. Stop the stereotypes.
Welcome back. The Penguins are looking ahead to playoffs and another run for the Stanley Cup.
Meanwhile, the Pirates are just getting started with opening day this Thursday in Detroit. To discuss our local sports news, let's toss things over to Kiara Fry. Kiara?
The Penguins finished off a season sweep of the Philadelphia Flyers on Sunday with a 5-4 victory in overtime. The game was tied in the third period until Sidney Crosby fended off Flyers defenseman Sean Couturier with one hand and scored, giving the Pens a 4-3 lead. With 43 seconds left in the third, Couturier scored, sending the game into overtime. Brian Rust redirected a pass from Crosby to score the game-winning goal. The Pens are now in the second in the Metropolitan Division, just one game behind the Washington Capitals. Tonight, they face the Red Wings in Detroit. Meanwhile, the Pirates took on the Toronto Blue Jays in Florida and came away with a 7-4 victory. The Pirates will start the regular season in Detroit later this week, but opening day in Pittsburgh will be April 2nd. Son of Pittsburgh Pirates legend Roberto Clemente visited Northgate High School students in Bellevue last Thursday. Roberto Clemente Jr. discussed the lessons his father taught him about setting goals and being dedicated to accomplishing them. At the heart of Clemente's message was an issue that has become a hot topic with recent school shootings, mental health. Clemente explained the importance of mental health and encouraged the youth to download an app named Roberto Clemente after his father. The app is a brain health and wellness tool that measures brain performance in just 6 minutes. Another new development involving former Pittsburgh athletes is happening on the football field as well. Former Pittsburgh Steelers Troy Polamalu and Hines Ward are joining with other former NFL players to launch a new football league called the Alliance of American Football League. Both former players will be serving as executives for the league. It will have a 10-week season starting next February. There will be 8 teams made up of players that were cut from NFL teams. The cities that will be home to these 8 teams will be announced in the coming months. The league's first game is set to air on CBS in February.
So this league is getting a leg up on the XFL that's making its return. So that's a very interesting development there. But Troy Polamalu and Hines Ward here, very interesting names, legendary names in the city. What are some of your favorite memories of either of the players when you were growing up?
Oh, it's impossible to pick a favorite memory or even favorite memories because they were such a big part of the Steelers team when I grew up watching them and started becoming interested in football. So it's just, they've meant so much to the team that it's really hard to pick just one.
Well, thanks, Kira. Now with this new alliance, league, whatever you want to call it, coming about, the NFL is still in the prime spotlight, and it's been a pretty busy offseason, I must say. I mean, you got trade rumors left and right, you got the Browns making some big names, but I don't know, can they really become a better team and put the curse that's been over them the past few decades to the wayside? I don't know.
And Le'Veon Bell still hasn't been signed, Sarah. So that is something that Pittsburgh is watching. Now, even though the NFL season is over and free agency is going on and the Browns making some move, will they actually be a contender? That's a big, big talking point during this offseason. Can they reverse that curse? I want to throw it over now to Aaron Becker to talk a little bit more about free agency and the rest of the NFL world and how it is developing. Aaron?
The face of the NFL is changing drastically this offseason. Almost every team is taking advantage of the rich talent available in free agency. After going 0-16, the Cleveland Browns have been very busy giving themselves a new look. Offensive tackle Joe Thomas, who recently retired, had 22 quarterbacks over his 11 seasons. But the Browns have acquired Tyrod Taylor from the Buffalo Bills and have already named him their starting quarterback for next season. They've also added offensive weapons in ex-Dolphins receiver Jarvis Landry and ex-49ers running back Carlos Hyde. The Steelers haven't made any splashy plays or moves in free agency, as they're still negotiating to sign Le'Veon Bell to a long-term contract. But they have signed ex-Colts linebacker John Bostic and ex-Packers safety Morgan Burnett. These players will help fill the roles of Ryan Chazier, who won't play in 2018 due to his back injury, and Mike Mitchell, who the Steelers recently released. Some other big moves? The Rams have strengthened their defense, biting corners Aqib Talib and Marcus Peters through trades with the Broncos and Chiefs. The 49ers signed Richard Sherman after the Seahawks released him, along with a number of other players, as they seem to be in a rebuilding phase. And the Vikings won the Kirk Cousins sweepstakes, moving on from their 3 previous starting quarterbacks, Case Keenum, who signed with the Broncos, Sam Bradford, who signed with the Cardinals, and Teddy Bridgewater, who signed with the Jets. The countdown to the 2018 NFL season has already begun, as it will be very exciting to watch and see if any of these big offseason moves will result in big wins for these teams.
Yes, well, we'll all be anxiously awaiting the upcoming NFL season. Well, thanks, Aaron. Coming up next, get your gloves ready. The Major League Baseball season kicks off this week, and we tell you who we're watching to have the big 2018 campaigns. Don't go anywhere.
Yeah.
What's one word to describe CAB?
Welcoming.
Community.
Creative.
Experiences.
Family.
Openness.
Pineapple.
The Campus Activities Board is a student-run organization that consists of seven different committees. Each focuses on event planning, marketing, and administrative activities. Join us in organizing the juiciest events on campus, from late-night bingo to festive dances to our team bonding meetings. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Point Park Cap, or like us on Facebook at Campus Activities Board at Point Park University.
Good evening and welcome to Newsnight. I'm Josh Krupp alongside Jess Patterchak.
Defending his decision to kick out 15 Cuban diplomats from the United States.
Thanks, Allison. Fitness on Demand has returned to Point Park.
Residents fear that Mount Agung will have a repeat of 1963's eruption.
Two-star NFL quarterbacks made the headlines this week after wrapping up.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. That's your news tonight. For Nick Tomarello, I'm Alex Grubbs. Have a great night.
Welcome back. The first pitch of the 2018 MLB season, comes to us this Thursday.
Yes, Sarah, the Buccos open up in Detroit. The Yankees field that monster lineup for the first time, and the Astros look to defend their World Series crown.
Yes, but what individual players are expected to have breakout seasons?
It's time for this week's Case of the Week with more of a discussion between you and I. Let's talk baseball, Sarah. The American League, may as well just dive right in. Who do you got in the MVP race winning that one this year?
For the American League, I'm going to go with Mike Trout. You know, it may seem like the obvious pick. Everyone's picking him first in their fantasy league drafts. But I think this may be the year for him. I mean, last year he finished fourth and he missed almost 50 games. And his average just keeps going up, 315, 306. I mean, and he hasn't struck out yet in spring training. And that's a huge deal. That's what separates, for me, him from guys like Giancarlo Stanton and Aaron Judge, who they may be able to whack the ball, but they do strike out a lot. And I think that's where Mike Trout kind of stands out. Granted, I think if the Nationals kind of go a little bit further in the playoffs, that could help his case. But that's who I have in terms of the MVP.
So I got Carlos Correa coming out of the AL. Really like Correa's game. Him and Altuve over in Houston, I think, have a good chance to repeat. They're a young team. If not repeat this year, then maybe win in the next couple of years. So I'm going Correa in the AL. What about Cy Young?
Cy Young, I mean, there are some good pitchers in the AL. I mean, we talk about Kluber, but my gut is Chris Sale. I mean, I think this year, last year was a disappointment for Boston. They expected to go further in the World Series. And so I think it's going to be a bounce back year for them. I mean, he got hit with that line drive in spring training, but unlike Madison Bumgarner, it's really not going to keep him out very long. And I think he's one of the most consistent pitchers in the entire MLB. I mean, his numbers have been consistent, a 2.98 career ERA, that's pretty good, and he's had 17 wins over the past two seasons. He can't really beat that. So, I mean, I like to see the kind of veteran Chris Sale getting it.
For time's sake, I'm just going to say Corey Kluber and move on to the NL. We don't have a lot of time, so quickly in the NL, what about your MVP?
I either Bryce Harper or Nolan Arenado. It's a toss-up for me. Bryce Harper, you know.
I like Arenado.
Yeah, Bryce Harper, I think his RBIs, that's what struggles for him. They're not where they need to be for someone that's contributing so high to his team, whereas Nolan Arenado's had 130-plus RBI season back-to-back seasons. That's pretty good.
Biggest disappointment in the league, I'm going Shohei Ohtani. I don't think he's going to have a good year.
Oh, no, definitely not. I mean, we just talked about his ERA is 27 and his batting average is under 100, just over 100. I mean, it's definitely that big name because that's those sweepstakes. Who's going to get Ohtani? But I don't really expect him to do much for the Angels this year.
And if you got Mike Trout and Ohtani there, who knows what the Angels are going to do? We already talked about World Series picks and who we think our best teams are going to be, but who's the biggest surprise this year in baseball?
That's a good one.
It could be a good or bad surprise. So maybe Giancarlo Stanton only plays 30 games, and he's a bad surprise.
See, I think, I don't know, the Yankees, I feel like they're going to, that offense is going to be there. I don't think it's going to take them to the point people think they are. But I look for either the Angels with Mike Trout, or I really like the Rockies. We brought up Nolan Arenado. I think it's just a matter of time. They get those few couple pitching issues out of the way, I think they could be a real contender in the NL.
The Rockies are quiet good, but it all comes down to that NL West, which is very unpredictable. How will Kutch and the Giants do? Will the Dodgers be able to be good?
Yes.
We could talk about this forever, but it's all the time we have for this week.
Join us again next week at the same Pioneer time.
The same Pioneer channel.
And the same Pioneer sideline.